How'd that go?
Not good. Like, how not good?
Are these on?
Yeah.
Probably. Where's going on?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Today is Tuesday, October 18th. It is 7 o'clock, and this is the Gateway Board of School Directors' regular voting meeting. If we could all please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. If we could do a roll call, Bonnie, please.
Mrs. Cerucci?
Here.
Mr. Lapsevich?
Here.
Mr. Nola?
Here.
Mr. O'Donnell?
Here.
Mr. Ritter?
Here.
Mr. Steubenbord?
Here.
Mrs. Warning?
Here.
Mr. Williams?
Here.
Hi, Scotty.
Hi, Scott.
Hello.
Good.
Hi.
So we will start with comments from residents on agenda items. Looks like we have one that had signed up in advance for agenda items, so we'll start with Mr. Coulter. If you could, just please state your name and your resident. For the record.
Good evening, everybody. Mark Holter, resident of Monroeville.
I wanted to talk about the minutes from last week's meeting, but when I was looking at the agenda that was prepared, it wasn't available yet because I was, at least I couldn't find it. Not knocking on it, may have been there. I was hoping what I was going to see was some correction of what I thought I heard last week, which was this board passing basically a giveaway on the Teamsters contract for what sounded like $50,000, and I was hoping that was going to be reflected some other way in the minutes, because if in fact that's what a slim majority of this board did, I mean, that was just a giveaway. That's patronage. That's just giving people things that wasn't a part of their contract, gratuitous gift, just a curry favor with a group of people, and that's not what this board is for. Even worse, it's a gift that nobody was asking for. I didn't hear people up here lobbying that, hey, we need this, we're entitled to this, you know, and instead, you guys just gave it away. And we live in a world of budget crisis, as Mr. Nola was talking about. If we do this now, what do we do next? What do? Pay other people? Don't even go down that road, please. But, you know, I have a student that's in an honors class with 34 students because we have trouble getting teaching and trouble getting adequate classrooms and everything. And yet we're just going to do this giveaway. It's just, honestly, I think it's a breach of your fiduciary duty. When there was a phone contract and somebody said, well, we should rebid this, we should rebid that, and yet we're just going to give away this money. I think it goes beyond just poor judgment. I think it's really an abuse of the authority that you had. And as the public, we didn't even have an opportunity to think about it ahead of time, because near as I can tell, it wasn't even on the agenda. You know, a board member gets to raise it up as a board resolution. We vote on it, boom, boom, boom. All of a sudden, we're out 50 grand. I pay my taxes every year. I pay them on time. If you don't need my money, I'll take it back. I got plenty of things I could use it for. I would hope you guys might find an opportunity to, if not revisit that one, in the future, give more careful attention to what you're really saying. We want to be everybody's friend, but you know what? The trash isn't going to be any emptier. The corn's not going to taste more like corn from these people. But what I know is that paying them is not going to make our students better. If we're going to bridge the education gap that we're trying to bridge, that's not what's going to bridge it. Thank you. I hope somehow the minutes will be magically fixed, but probably not. Thanks for the indulgence.
Thank you, Mr. Coulter. Would anyone else like to speak on agenda items and agenda items only? Seeing none.
I would like to make a motion to go into executive session for personnel, please.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Seeing none, we will recess into executive session.
I had to play my phone.
Call Bonnie, please. All righty, we are finished with executive session. Do we have a motion to come back into?
I'd like a motion.
Motion. There's a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Seeing none, we will move along with the agenda. We will start off with Section A, minutes from the previous meetings. Mrs. Isha.
School directors approves the minutes of the previously held meetings, the study session meeting September 6, 2016, and the regular board meeting September 20, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Seeing none, minutes pass. We'll move on to Section B, bills and list of and financial reports. Mr. Schott.
Section B, resolved that the Gateway Board of School Directors approves Sections B1 list of bills, B2 monthly financial statements, and B3 budget transfers as listed in Section B of the Tuesday, October 18, 2016 regular board meeting.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, we'll do roll call. Bonnie, please.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsevich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Very good. We do not have any items previously tabled. We will move on to Section D, personnel agenda. Mrs. Crum.
Can I ask before we start voting, could we vote separately on all these items, Bonnie? Is that okay? I know we talked about it before, but I still feel I think it would be better if we could do that.
Do we want to, is there anyone that you'd like to pull out individually?
No, I would just like to do each section individual.
So
that's Bonnie,
each
is that okay?
Or each individual?
One through eight.
One through eight.
So we'd like to take a motion.
One vote.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, resolved that the Gateway Board of School Directors accepts and approves the personnel agenda items as listed under section number one, resignation. We're accepting the resignation of Diane Campbell, autistic aide.
So moved.
We have a motion. We have a second.
I was
second.
Thank you.
Any questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call Bonnie, please.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne?
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci?
Aye.
Mr. Lapsevich?
Aye.
Under Section 2, transfers, approve the transfer of Cindy Anderson from substitute custodian to temporary full-time custodian.
So moved.
Second. We have a motion. We have a second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call Bonnie, please.
Mr. Nola?
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort?
Aye.
Mrs. Warning?
Aye.
Mr. Williams?
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne?
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci?
Aye.
Mr. Lapsevich?
Aye.
Under Section 3, leaves of absences, we have three leaves there for Kelly Ethorn, Stephanie Ruby, and Jeremy Stillwagon.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call Bonnie, please.
Mr. O'Donnell?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort?
Aye.
Mrs. Warning?
Aye.
Mr. Williams?
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne?
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci?
Aye.
Mr. Lapsevich?
Aye.
Mr. Nola?
Aye.
Under Section 4 for tenure, recognize and record in the records of the board that in accordance with the Pennsylvania statutes, Title 24, Section 1108 of the Pennsylvania School Code, the following temporary professional employees have acquired tenure. That will go to Karen Montgomery, Sean McMasters, David Verno, and Tara Weissert.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call Bonnie, please.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort?
Aye.
Mrs. Warning?
Aye.
Mr. Williams?
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne?
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci?
Aye.
Mr. Lapsevich?
Aye.
Mr. Nola?
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell?
Aye.
Under Section 5 for employment, we have two substitute custodians listed and one substitute secretary.
Aye, so moved.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call Bonnie, please.
Mr. Steubenbort?
Aye.
Mrs. Warning?
Aye.
Mr. Williams?
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne?
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci?
Aye.
Mr. Lapsevich?
Aye.
Mr. Nola?
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
Under Section 6 for supplemental contracts, we have one resignation. Under Section B, there are three issuances of contracts. And under Section C, that is a new addition since the agenda meeting last time. That's a rate increase for the supplemental contracts. It's to approve a 1% increase for supplemental contracts as per the collective bargaining agreement.
What this is for is we did some 16-17 supplementals approval in June before the board passed the budget. So the listings that we did in June 15th or June 16 were the 15-16 rates. This is to increase it to the 1% for those 35 individuals that we did in June. It is budgeted. It is the correct amount. It gives a total of $1,395. Doing it this way, it limits us from having to give Bonnie the individual names and she redo letters for each of them.
So moved.
Second.
A motion and a second.
Any questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call Bonnie, please.
Mrs. Warney.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsovich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbord.
Aye.
Under Section 7 for volunteers, we have 4 volunteers listed for independent volunteers.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call Bonnie, please.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsovich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbord.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye. And lastly, for Section 8, a salary increase for our substitute workers. For custodians, it will raise from $9.25 to $11 per hour. Secretaries will go from $7.50 to $10. Food service, $7.25 to $8.50. And the teacher's aides from $7.25 to $10.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any questions or comments?
I have a question. I'm glad we are increasing the rates. When I look at this and I see secretaries are only going up to 10, custodians are going up to 11. I see that secretaries deal with a lot more confidentiality issues than a custodian. Do we take that into consideration at all?
We do take it into consideration. We did a survey of all the surrounding districts, of the 7 districts around us, and took an average and then upped that by about 50 cents, so it would be above the average. We can make it whatever you choose to make it, but after looking at the survey, that was what we felt was a fair and suggested price.
Okay.
I believe this is what the board had asked management to do, because so the public understands, we were having difficulty attracting custodians, retaining secretaries at 7.25, 7.50 an hour, 7.25 for teacher aides. So we wanted to strengthen our hand in the market and asked administration to examine that matter, gather the data, and bring back recommendations. And these are the recommendations you're making.
That's correct. Okay. Just so the public understands that we've reached a critical phase of, as far as attracting and maintaining substitutes across the board, not only in custodial, but also within the buildings as far as teachers. So we're hopefully becoming more competitive with the rates to ensure that we have individuals available.
And we had to control the overtime that we've been paying out to with the employees.
Yeah,
that's correct. That's a good point.
Will we be able to look at this and make sure that there is a cost savings?
Yes.
We're going to do a
what we're going to start doing is comparing the rates of what we do for substitutes and then our overtime rates. Hopefully the overtime rate will go down, and then the substitute pay rate will go up.
Okay.
That's well, can we have a report back like in a couple months, maybe 3
tomorrow.
Months?
Tomorrow, sure. No problem.
No, I think we want to see.
January. Because the first thing, we'll have to get the pool built up. It is devastatingly low, so you're not going to see anything.
If you say no for it, then I'll say okay. But, so I think...
If we're making a change for a reason, we need to make sure that the savings is actually occurring. If we're wasting more money, that's obviously a bad move. So.
All right, any other questions or comments on number 8? Seeing none, roll call Bonnie, please.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsovich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbord.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye. All right, we'll move on to our new Section E, Conferences and Conventions. Mr. Short.
Thank you, Mr. Steubenbord. Resolved that the Gateway Board of School Directors approves and authorizes the following conferences and conventions as listed in Section E. We have item number 1, conferences and conventions. We have a number of our school police officers who will be attending the basic SRO training. You see the dates and the fees and also the place where they will be attending that.
We have two more.
Yes, there are two more on page two. Yes, we have Angela Dietrich. A sub is required for the 67th Annual Conference of Dyslexia. And also Mr. Mike Crestar, our librarian, attending a media coordinators meeting.
Okay, we have second. A motion. We have a second. Any questions or comments?
Yeah, I have a question. Go ahead.
Joseph?
So I see this is basic SRO training. Is there another level of SRO training available, or is that just... Okay.
Also found invaluable to retain him for a bit longer.
Okay. Are those hard to come by? Those conferences or conventions, and for an advanced SRO training, or is it just one of those things where the basic one is the one that's more often offered?
Well, this one, I believe, and
this one was
specially
arranged for us because we had.
Five people or more,
they coordinated a special training specifically just for the Gateway SROs, and we bumped it up on the schedule due to the discussions we've been having and the concerns about training to get it implemented quicker. So I can get information from Mr. Skoog on advanced SRO training if you would like.
This will give us six SROs now, which is four more than we've ever had before. Or not ever.
Sure. Mr. Lefsovich.
Mary Beth.
Yes, sir.
Just a question, curiosity. We're sending one, is that a lady? Yeah.
Yeah, why is she more money?
To Orlando, Florida?
No, that's not an SRO. That's the special ed training.
Oh, I'm sorry, I thought they were called.
Teacher.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, but Kathy is in at a higher rate because she's the one that's driving, so she
okay,
gets mileage.
No, I could see that, but I just, okay. I thought these were officers too.
No, unfortunately, sorry. Our SROs don't get to go to Florida.
Okay, question. I guess I can direct this to Mr. Dice. Is there any more information on the process, on the procedure, or how everything is going with the appeal?
You want to touch on that?
Sure.
Are we about to?
Yeah, why don't I touch upon my report?
Okay, because my question is, if it's sitting idle and if it's, I don't want to say not going to pass, then we're spending money on conferences for what, is what I'm saying.
For what is that we still, these people are going to be in the schools and
correct.
We should have them
correct.
Trained.
But what I'm saying is,
the SRO training is valuable to them whether or not they're carrying a firearm or have the authority to write a summary offense or not.
Right.
So I think moving forward and getting them an SRO training is valuable either way.
Okay, my question is, if the appeal does not pass, then they are still considered just security guards. I'm just, interrupt me if well, I'm...
They're considered, no, I consider them...
They're retired police
trained,
officers.
Correct, but what they can
SROs.
Do... But what can they do in a school more than a security guard is what I'm asking right now. They have no...
They'll be trained SROs.
But right now, I'm looking at right now.
Right now, they can do everything they can do except for carrying.
No training compared to people that have 25 years of
correct.
Service.
But they can't do anything more than security guards at this point. Am I correct in saying
no,
that?
No, that's not true.
I disagree with that statement.
Well, they can do 25 years of experience as a law enforcement officer along with being an SRO. That's what they can do that our old security guards would not have.
As far as issuing citations, I guess if you're going that far, yes, that there would be the same. Neither one of them could write citations, but I think there's no
I'm not
debate
saying,
as to their training.
I'm not saying anything about their training, but yeah. I'm just saying if the appeal does not move forward and it's not...
Well, rest assured it's moving forward, but
okay.
I'll report in my report.
Okay.
I have a question going along with that.
So they're currently wearing a uniform that says police. Are they technically a police officer? I mean, I know they're retired, but are they currently a police officer when they wear that uniform?
Are you asking me?
Yes, please.
They're not a police officer.
Okay.
You know, they don't have the power to arrest. They don't have the power to issue citations. They don't have the power to carry guns.
Right now, we have retired police officers functioning as school security.
Yes.
If you want to know the legal terminology. They're wearing polo shirts that say police on the back.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments on conferences and conventions?
Well, just to follow up on that, Bruce, that's, I'm guessing your silence on this means that's not an issue.
It's not an issue to me.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call, Bonnie, please.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsvich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye to the last two teachers, no to the training for the SRO.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Thank you very much. We will move on to Section F, Administrative Resolutions.
I don't know.
Mr. Short. Defer to Mr. Schott to handle a number of these. I will interject as we move forward. There are a number of items that we will need to vote on individually, Bonnie. So, Mr. Schott.
The very top before I read each individual one. Resolved that the Gateway Board of School Directors approves and authorizes the following items as listed in Section F at the regular board meeting of Tuesday, October 18, 2016. Item number one, approval to advertise a request for proposal for a new district phone system, phone service, and redundant internet service.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call, Bonnie, please.
Mr. Lapsvich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
No.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
No.
Mr. Williams.
No.
Mrs. Byrne.
Yes.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Yes.
Motion carries.
Motion carries 6-3.
Item number two, service agreement for medical waste disposal services with Stericycle from November 1st, 2016 through October 31st, 2021 at $196 per month and as depicted in Exhibit A.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call, Bonnie, please.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Sorry, Mr. O'Donnell?
Aye.
Okay, I'm sorry. Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
It's just to advertise.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsvich.
Aye.
Item number three, approval of disposal service agreement with Shred-It for additional services required during the 2016-17 fiscal year at the unit prices as indicated and as depicted in Exhibit B.
So moved.
Second. We have a motion. We have a second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call, Bonnie, please.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsvich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Item number four, district donations received, specifically $1,000 from Westmoreland Hospital for Cleveland Stewart Elementary, and also $1,000 from Phipps Conservatory, also for Cleveland Stewart Elementary School.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call, Bonnie, please.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsvich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
And Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Item number five, overnight excursions. Approve the following overnight excursions. First one being for the high school marching band going to Boston. Second, Scholastic Winter Guard going to Dayton, Ohio, for the dates as indicated.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. I'm going to start out with a comment, or a question. The cost per student, did we find out, is that what the district cost is? Is there fundraising? Is that?
My understanding is this will be covered by the Boost organization, that $662 fee for transportation.
Could we have... I mean, is that solid or is that?
Let me check again with Mr. Helchy.
Okay.
So wait. So we can approve it based on its.
Yes.
We're just voting to pay for Mr. Helchy to accompany them, correct?
But it's basically authorizing.
It's authorized.
But last time we had a question on the personal payment fundraising, so that is going to be provided, or that's all through the bank.
So we're voting on authorizing them to go, not the cost.
Correct.
Per se.
Any other questions or comments on overnight excursions?
How many students are you talking about going to this conference?
Well, the entire Gateway High School marching band.
Roughly 115.
Yeah.
115?
Students.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments from the board for overnight excursions? Seeing none, roll call Bonnie, please.
Mr. Stugelbord.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Excuse me, aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsevich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Item number six, is a motion authorizing the selection of ABM Building Solutions, LLC, for an energy services contract under Pennsylvania Act 39 of 2010.
Hard.
We have a motion.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none. Roll.
Yeah. Roll. Yeah. I have a comment.
Go ahead.
Today.
Yeah. I just want to make sure I'm reading exactly what it says. I want to make sure. I'm good. Actually, I don't need to comment.
All right. Roll call Bonnie, please.
Mrs. Warning.
No.
Mr. Williams.
No.
Mrs. Byrne.
No.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Yes.
Mr. Lapsevich.
No.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
No.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Stubenbort.
Aye. Motion fails.
For that, for these people that voted no on why we're not proceeding with energy saving analysis for our school district.
You can make comments during board reports. We'll move on to Section G, resolutions presented by board members. Do we have any this evening? Seeing none, we'll move on to comments from residents on non-agenda items. We did have two that had signed up in advance, and we will start with Nancy Lapsevich. Could just state your name, Nancy, for the record.
I'll use this tonight. Give me a minute. I'm not used to using my phone, okay? Good evening. My name's Nancy Lapsevich. I'm a resident of Monroeville. I'm an RN. I'm a CCRN. That's a critical care registered nurse certified. And I have my bachelor's degree in nursing. Just wanted to give you a little bit of a history of maybe why I'm speaking and why it's dear to me. I've been on both sides of the drug epidemic. As a parent and as a nurse, neither side is attractive. Neither side. But it is a epidemic, and don't think it isn't. So I know why I'm here, and you probably know why I'm here. I started this quest in February to ask for Narcan in the school. Narcan is an opiate antagonist. It stops the effect of the Vicodin, heroin, morphine, fentanyl, anything that's considered a class of an opiate. You can do CPR all you want. But if they're not treated with the Narcan, it's not going to work. For 9 months, I have been here numerous times asking. In those 9 months, I could have given you another child for the school, but I didn't deliver, and neither did the board. They didn't deliver on this either. It boggles my mind. In Pennsylvania, there's 128, or in Allegheny County, 128 school districts with Narcan on board. Not only at the high school level, some have it in their trade schools and in their middle schools. And I'm not just talking addicts here. I'm talking anyone that takes that pill, puts that needle in their arm, or snorts that coke. You don't know what an effect it's going to have. The media level of kids that are doing this are 12 to 17. 12! They should be worrying about television, not drugs, but they're doing it. A lot of the problem is the kids that are on drugs, their parents are probably still doing it because their parents are probably in their 30s and 40s. Not saying that's across the board statement, but it's a possibility. Sometimes that's where we know where they get it from. Be as it may, if a child gets down or an adult in school, like I said, without that Narcan, forget it. CPR is not going to work. Minimum 0 to 5 minutes without oxygen, the brain starts disintegrating. There's the brain starts with lack of oxygen, then the rest of the system. They need that treatment immediately. Anybody can give it. I could probably go to Giant Eagle now and get Narcan. That's how bad it is. So why not have the schools here? Why not have them have it? There's only 160 child difference between who you have in the whole school system of Gateway and who's died because of these drugs. The scary part is, by next year, those numbers are going to be even. That's the scary part. With addiction, right along comes death. It's just a fact. In 2014, our governor, and you've heard this story many times before, signed Act 139, which he wanted the schools to have the Narcan. He was pushing for it. February of this year, he really pushed for it. He wants the schools to have it. You can get samples of policies to write up. You can get samples of anything just by going to the health site. There's also the nurse that has more letters than I can remember after her name, that is the state school nurse, for lack of a better word. You can get them under the PSBA, the Pennsylvania School Board Association. There's all these places to go to find the information, but it can't be done without the school physician, the school nurse, the solicitor, and the board. What I'm asking is, don't wait another 9 months, please. Don't wait until one child needs it. You don't want to do that. We have, talking about armed police in the school, it's wonderful. You want them there, you want them equipped, but you don't ever want them to do their job. And that's like Narcan. You want it at the school, you want it there, but you pray to God no one ever has to use it. All I'm asking again, and I will be back, is that you work on a policy You work on getting it in. They will give it to you free. Chad knows the particulars.
I'll give you an update whenever
you're... Okay. Thank you all.
Very good. Thank you, Nancy. And just to give you an update, that was passed in February. In May, PSBA came out with a sample policy. Our head nurse at that time had reviewed it. We had several conversations, some concerns that they had. The next step was to have our school physician look at it, because the school physician actually has to okay it, because the Narcan will actually be placed under his medical order. So anything that happens with the Narcan misuse, training, all that goes under that MD's number. So he has finally said he is okay with it. We've since had our lead nurse retire, and our new lead nurse, and actually a group of our nurses, met on Monday and reviewed the policy. The policy committee members will be getting together at 1 o'clock tomorrow, and actually going through the policy audit, continuing that, and the Narcan policy is one of the policies we will be reviewing. So hopefully for our next study session, we'll have it on, and we can then display it for 30 days and hopefully approve it by the action meeting there.
Thank you for all your work. You're
welcome. Just wanted to give you an update there. We have one other resident who had signed up. Dave?
Good evening, everybody. I'm sure you know why I'm here. Thank you for hearing me out. I made my council television debut a few weeks ago, because after the last meeting when we discussed this and the appeal, I called the mayor, called the chief of police, called the guy in the, I saw an article in the paper, I called the president of the NAACP, and he's against the school guards. And what I'm wondering is there a plan B? Is this an all or nothing proposition? Can't we have three or four armed policemen and the rest? I applaud your training of the SROs. I think that's a good idea. They called them school policemen in Judge O'Reilly's denial of the petition, and I got a chance to come up to the school board and file a need to know writ and get a copy of it. And I read it thoroughly a few times, and there's a few disturbing things in it, but I won't beat a dead horse to death. I think there's been a lack of due diligence on the part of the board. I know you want to do this. I want to say that I agree with you that there should be security guards in every building. I think the ideal number of security guards you should have is 16, probably 18, which was in the original petition, because you have seven buildings. You need two guys in the high school, and you need six officers in the other buildings. And I'll go against my daughter's wishes. There's a way to do it, whereas you can use eight guys working 5 days a week and eight guys working 3 hours a week, or 5 days, 5 hours a day, 5 days a week, and the other eight working 3 hours a day, 5 days a week. So those officers can cover football games and choir practice, or the winter festival, the plays. I don't know if you, I go to basketball games, so I know there's police at basketball games. And what I'd like to suggest, that in case the court turns you down again, that we not litigate this like we did the firing of the police chief. You know, I'm the taxpayer. You know, they spent $2.5 million on lawsuits about hiring and firing, and I believe this is also about the same thing. You know, $75,000 is 0.01% of this school district's budget. And if you add the borough's $30 million budget, you're still talking about .001. And I think it's just unsafe. And unfortunately, or fortunately, I had a I ran into two policemen. I was going to get a cup of decaf coffee at Sheets, and I ran into two policemen, and I asked them a simple question. I asked them if they had a round in the chamber of their gun. And they said, yes, of course. I said, is the safety on? And he said, no safety. And we all heard in the newspaper the other day that a security guard took his handgun into the men's room, set it on a shelf, and forgot it, and went back to work, and a kid turned it into a school teacher. Somebody's going to get hurt. Somebody's going to get hurt. Not necessarily with a gun, because I'm not saying somebody's going to get shot. But please, you know, think about it. Have four armed guards, four policemen, and rotate them through the buildings so nobody can predict when they're going to go to that building if there's an armed guy there. Because I'll give you one scenario to think about. I'm an irate father. I haven't seen my kids in 9 months, and I want to go to the school Friday afternoon and get my kids because I haven't had my kids for a weekend for 8 or 9 months. And I know there's an armed guard there. I'm not showing up with my .22 target pistol. I'm probably going to show up with my AR-15 or my AK-47 or my 9mm automatic with a 16-round clip. Thank you.
Thank you, Dave.
Consider it, please.
Do we have any other residents that would like to address the board this evening? Seeing none, we will move on to administrative reports, and we will start with Mrs. Crump.
Import. We'd just like to welcome all the applications that we hope will be coming in tomorrow. Since we've raised all of our rates for all of our substitutes, we will be diligently looking, so please. See, there's one already.
Thank you.
Mr. Shaw? Nothing further. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr.
Dice? Yes, to address Valerie's point, we have received notice from the Commonwealth Court that they have received all the records that are necessary to move forward with the appeal. What will come out next from the Commonwealth Court will be a briefing schedule. I anticipate getting that certainly before Thanksgiving. I would think that after that, I'll give you another update as to how far or how long it's going to take to go forward with that appeal. But as I said to you at one time, it's probably a good part of a year before you're going to get a decision from the Commonwealth Court. As to the other items that have been brought up about whether or not we should or shouldn't have SROs or should or shouldn't have training, I don't know. I assume everybody has now read the decision of the judge, the 9-page memorandum. I don't know if you're reading that to mean that you can never, ever, ever have a school police force, because that's not what the judge was saying. He does not say in there, you can never, ever have a school police force. Rather, he said, you should put more thought into it. You should get some opinions from some of the experts in this area and give some more consideration to the formation of a police force. You should evidence training for the police officers. Well, this is a little piece of that. You are now beginning the training. I don't know of any other school district, I would say in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, that has 6 or 7 SRO officers. That doesn't happen. And I think that the goal here is to eventually make all of the part-time officers at least at elementary SRO officers. There is an advanced course, Val, and Steph, that you talked about. That's offered on a limited basis during the year, not as often as the regular entry-level SRO force schedule and training. But don't read Judge O'Reilly's decision as saying you can't go back in. If after you've done some more review and you've decided that you think that these officers now
sit in a different seat than they did then, and you've given more thought to it, got some experts to offer some opinions, that you can't go back in, you could. And that starts over with a whole brand new petition. You could also change the relief, as was indicated. You know, it's firearms, it's arrest powers, it's citations. You could eliminate some of those things. One of them, two of them. You could change exactly what it is you want to do. So you're free to do and use your imaginations for the future. So you could very well see in the near future another petition being drawn if this board so chooses and votes to, if a majority of the board says that they want to move forward with that, and that would then be presented to the court again. Now, when I say the court, it goes to the motions judge, it goes to the court of common pleas, and whoever it is that they assign it to, they assign it to. That doesn't mean it goes back to Judge O'Reilly. It doesn't mean it won't. I've even given some thought, if we did this again, what better place to bring a petition for a police force than criminal court? You know, we could petition the criminal court and say, let's hear what you have to say, because they deal with police forces all the time. The civil court doesn't deal with the police forces, other than in accident cases or when they're called as professional witnesses. But they don't deal with police on a daily basis like the criminal court does. So maybe we'll decide, and none of this is in stone at this point. It's conceptual. If there's enough change done, and if there's enough thought put into it, and experts tell you that this is a good thing, you might want to move forward with a second petition, which at that point, if you go forward and a court grants it, it really kind of starts to moot the case you have in Commonwealth Court. When I say moot it, you may decide at that point, okay, well, we're going to withdraw the Commonwealth Court decision. On the other hand, you might want to set the precedent. You might want to have the stare decisis. You might want to have the judge have his decision reviewed and scrutinized by the appellate courts. So that's going to be up to you. None of this is firmed out. None of it's in writing yet, but it's conceptual. And I throw it out to you so you hear it. There's no questions from the audience at this point.
Are you, with respect to filing out with criminal court or refiling in common pleas court?
I can't do anything until this board acts.
So are you waiting for this board's authority to do that?
The board needs to consider the adoption of a second resolution if you think you're ready to do that either now or sometime in the future.
Right.
And there is no timeline, what I'm sitting here right. saying. So you would need to, you'd adopt another resolution.
So if this board passed another resolution, an action item at the next study session that would direct you to refile, that resolution could say either refile in criminal court or refile in civil court?
No, that wouldn't be your decision. That would be mine. It's okay. Common pleas court.
So, the same. So you're looking for an authority to refile. Okay.
I'm not looking for that at this point. I haven't asked for it.
No.
I'm just suggesting to you that you don't read Judge O'Reilly's opinion as you can never, ever do this.
No, I understand that fully. Because, you know, because these orders are routinely signed right away. Routinely signed right away.
The day they're presented.
Right. And this judge has chosen to take the path that he's chosen to take. Why wouldn't the board want to then authorize you to go back and refile in the Commonwealth Court?
Well, if you looked at his opinion, he made reference to certain experts he wanted to have some opinion
on.
I'm in the process of doing that.
All right, so if we cure those things or they're cured, then we're...
Well, I don't see them as cures. What somebody can say is, well, you did what the judge said there.
All right, I'm considering that a cure to the deficit of...
Because no one else across the Commonwealth has had to do any of that.
I know, I understand. Okay. All right.
Excuse me. Can I just ask one other question?
No, the public comments is over. Session meeting is over.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it doesn't matter. You're always talking about the Gateway.
You're out of order right now. You have to recognize.
Okay. Okay. I'm sorry. I should have included in my remarks.
Well, you can do it next month.
I'm sure.
And yeah, Mr. Reyes.
I'm happy to talk to you after the meeting.
Oh, okay. Mr.
Shakey. Thanks, Mr. Stevenport. First of all, I'd just like to thank the Gateway community for welcoming me over the last couple weeks. It's truly been a privilege visiting the schools, seeing some of the staff's passion and dedication for our students. I've seen some excellent things over the last couple weeks. I've met with principals, had a chance to meet a lot of teachers, and the focus going forward is going to be an emphasis on instructional leadership with the principals, with the intent of really showcasing the excellent instruction that's going on in all of our schools. So we look forward to our work together, and we're really excited about making Gateway School District the best it can possibly be. Thank you.
Next, we'll go over to Guy Rossi, our other assistant superintendent, who just started yesterday. So welcome to Gateway. And Mr. Rossi, do you have anything this evening?
I said I had a great 2 days. I look forward to the next couple weeks spending a lot of my time in the buildings, visiting with the principals, the teachers, the faculty, the staff. And I look forward to working with you as we continue to move forward. So thank you.
Very good. Thank you, Guy. And we'll move on to Mr. Short.
Thank you, Mr. Student Board. Couple of items. Just wanted to acknowledge our staff and presenters. Last Monday on October 10th, we held a professional development within the district. We had the Arts Education Collaborative. Gateway hosted that. Mr. Eric Lassick welcomed nearly 120 teachers from Western Pennsylvania who participated in professional development, and it was very well received. Also, we had Dr. Timothy Neftali that I mentioned previously from CNN, the 70s, the 80s series. He is a history professor from New York University and also is responsible for the Nixon Library, which is opening up real soon and making some additions to that. And he truly mesmerized, I think, all in attendance. We had educators from North Allegheny, the Plum School District, and was just a fascinating individual that really supplied our social studies teachers and a number of teachers with information that they will be able to take and then transfer into the classrooms. Also, I wanted to take a special moment here to acknowledge the work of our students and staff and administrators. Last week, we had the Pennsylvania School Performance Profile scores released to the public. And this is primarily the report card of how each and every one of our schools, not only within the district, but the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, are performing academically based on the PSSA assessments and grades K through 8. And then the Keystone exams, which are end-of-the-year courses in algebra, biology, and literature at Gateway High School. Last year, we were ecstatic with our score. We broke into the top 10 in Allegheny County based off of our SPP score of 84.4. I am proud to say that we have beaten that individual mark. We are now sitting at 89.8. We have supplanted the number one ranked school in Allegheny County, which was Hampton High School, number two Moon Area High School, and number three West Allegheny High School. We outperformed them this year on the SPP. Just to give everyone an idea in our community of where we stand, the school districts ahead of Gateway right now are Upper St. Clair, Mount Lebanon, Fox Chapel, North Allegheny, Pine Richland, and maybe one or two more. So we are currently eighth in Allegheny County. In the western half of the state, think about this for a moment, 13th out of nearly 180 high schools in the western half of Pennsylvania. Phenomenal, truly phenomenal scores. Also, Gateway Middle School was within the top 20% in Allegheny County. and I have to acknowledge the work of our elementary buildings, who have gone for years without an aligned PA core curriculum. We put that in place. We have seen significant increases, most notably Cleveland Stewart Elementary, which went from a score of 63 2 years ago up to nearly 77. Evergreen Elementary jumped up to 80. Great things are happening within this district. There is a plan in place. It is an improvement plan that everyone has been following. The efforts of our students, the community, our parents, and our staff should be highlighted, and we will celebrate the success of what we are offering here at Gateway. Truly incredible work. I do know that Dr. Rossi and Dr. Chakey will be going down to the intermediate unit tomorrow. This is where they unveil the top 10 rankings based off of the SPP, and I am sure they will get those looks that, wow, look at what Gateway's doing. So to everyone out there viewing, let's be proud of where we're at right now. Gateway is here, and we are making tremendous, tremendous strides in education. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. We will now move on to board reports, and we will start with Mr. Ritter.
Sure. Well, Alex Portis is, what, an eighth or ninth grader who's a baking champion, and he was on that Food Network challenge where the kids had to bake some sort of, you know, fun monsters, and they were given some ingredients. So here's what Alex did. This is brilliant. He took some peanut butter and some Krispies or something like that, and he put them down, and then he took his cake and put it on top, and he built himself a little monster hippo or something like that using a three-dimensional approach to cake baking. When the judges saw that, they saw that the other kids had made their cake, you know, in two dimensions and sort of decorate it. Alex broke the mold, and he made a three-dimensional cake. When I saw that on the Food Network, I thought, there's a piece of genius right there, because most people don't think in three dimensions, they think in two. That's how Kirk beat Ricardo Montalban in The Wrath of Khan. He went down and came under, and he came back up and shot him from behind because he was able to think in three dimensions. So what I'm saying is, the teachers here at Gateway High School are to be applauded for helping the kids think outside the box like this. This is brilliance. And it's not just with Alex, but many of the other kids have these seeds of greatness in them. So if the teachers can find that and nurture it, like they're doing with Alex right now, he's on the forefront, that's okay. There are many other kids with many other talents that would stun us. We ought to encourage that, and vice versa. If the teachers can learn from the students, that would be wonderful as well. And so here we are, Mr. Dice. We are a school board also struggling to try to think outside the box to best protect our students. We're trying to come up with a way to do it. It might work, it might not. We don't know. We're giving it our level best, but we're thinking outside the box. I hope it works, but we don't know if it will. So that's my report. A pat on the back to Alex. I think a pat on the back to us. We're hoping that the folks in the school district hold us accountable, not to put us down, but to help us succeed. We want to succeed, not for ourselves, but on behalf of the students and the parents here. So that's my report.
Thank you. Mary Beth.
Well, let's start briefly with a little security budget update. I had a request to just kind of review where we were with the budget, because there were some concerns or inquiries on whether we were would or projected to be over budget, and I can happily report, thanks to my conversations with Mr. Schott, that we are not anywhere near over budget or have any projections of going over budget. So part of that reason is because when we budgeted at the beginning of the year, we were planning on being fully staffed. So we budgeted for the full 18. Right now we're functioning at 13. So we have a significant cost savings already in our salaries. So As far as the money that was budgeted for supplies, we are also well within budget, and Paul can confirm that. So if there's anyone out there that is hearing rumors that we've overspent or we're over budget, that is absolutely 100% false, and we are very diligent with this project to try to stay within budget. So I just wanted to reiterate that to the community. And as far as training in the last meeting, and I also received some emails from some concerned parents of special needs students about training for our school police officers, and I would like them to be aware that Monday during in-service day, those officers did undergo a de-escalation training that was put on by Lou Randall, and those are de-escalation techniques that are specific to the special needs kids. And then, as you heard in the meeting, we also are voted to send 5 of them to the SRO training next month. So that's an update on the training and the budget for security. Now, ABM. I'm a little surprised and disappointed that my colleagues didn't move forward with this. And I just want to give a brief background. And let's go back to the condition of our schools. And as long as I can remember now, we've been talking about what we're going to do with the Mossside Middle School and the Gateway Middle School. Since my son was in fifth grade, that school has looked exactly the same. We have put no money into it because I've been hearing, as everybody in the community has been hearing, we're going to close the school. We're going to close the school. We're going to close the school. I ran for school board. Those of you who know me and see me know that I'm a person of action. I got on this board to make decisions and move forward with initiatives. I have huge concerns over the HVA system, the roofs, the aging buildings. We have toilets that have been installed since the buildings were built, faucets that were installed since the buildings were built. We have an HVA system at Ramsey that, according to the report from ABM and Schneider, is nearing the end of its usable life. These are legitimate concerns that we are not going to have heat. I do not want to get a phone call in January, February, March that says Ramsey's heat is broke. What are we going to do? So Mr. Brown has been working for about a year on trying to come up with a long-term plan to address these issues of all of our aging buildings. So, you know, this is why, in my opinion, we hired a manager to come up with ideas and invite companies in, which he did, to look at solutions. And then it's my job as a board member to take those solutions that are presented to me by Mr. Brown or administration, ask questions and see if we're in agreement, and try to look out for the money and the finances of the community. It's not my job to go and decide how we're going to do the buildings and how we're going to upgrade them. So I know I'm long-winded. So Mr. Brown put out to bid, with the advice of the administration, a plan that he wanted to move forward with. And we got 2 bids, ABM and Schneider. And the recommendation from Mr. Brown and the administration was to go with ABM. I didn't have a problem with that. So the public knows ABM was going to evaluate all of our buildings. They were going to look at our needs for heating, cooling, doors, insulation, water saving measurements, electrical upgrades, system controls, because Mr. Brown cannot control the heat from point B unless he goes to point A. Different things we can do to save money. ABM was going to inventory all of these things in all of our buildings, tell us the usable life of them, tell us how much money we would save by replacing them, and then let us pick and choose what we felt we wanted to spend and what we felt we wanted to upgrade based on those cost-saving measures. And ABM was going to, and so was Schneider, guarantee the savings. If they gave us an upgrade and said, you'll save X amount of dollars, if we didn't save it, they were going to write us a check for the difference. So on top of the inventory, the assessment, we had a guaranteed savings from them, and we also had a project manager. And one question I had when this was first presented to me was, well, Mr. Brown, why can't we do this ourselves? Why do we need ABM? Why do we need Schneider? And he said, I need a project manager. This is too much for us to do with our staff. So to me, the service of ABM or Schneider is to be a project manager for this. So, okay, so 5 of my colleagues tonight says no, they don't want to do what the building and grounds manager and the administration recommended. We are trying to move forward with a 5-year plan to upgrade our buildings. So I want my colleagues then to somehow come back to me and put me at ease with what we're going to do, because if you vote no on this, we need a new plan really fast. Okay, we cannot sit here for another 5 years and I can't think of the word because the one I want to use isn't going to come out of my mouth. We can't sit around here and wait another 5 years and try to decide what we're going to do with Moss Side Middle and what we're going to do with Gateway Junior High, because we're going to have problems that can't be fixed. And that's my concern. So to my colleagues who don't think this is a good idea, I am going to challenge you to please come forward with an alternative solution so that, you know, we don't get a phone call in January that the heat broke at Ramsey and we have to cancel school or move those kids into a trailer somewhere else, because we know now, we have no excuse that these systems are nearing the end of life and they need repair. So that's my concern with you. I respect the differences of opinion. I look forward to hearing your reasons on why you don't want to move forward this. But, you know, most importantly, I'm concerned that we're going to sit here and do nothing and waste more time, and that we're going to be reactionary and we're going to have a crisis on our hands. And I don't want to play defense here. I want to play offense. And I think the public deserves for us to play offense and fix these aging buildings and come up with a plan and move forward with it. And that's all I have to say.
Scott, are you still with us? Okay, we will move on to Mrs. Warning.
Scotty,
you're cutting out. We can't understand you, bud.
Could you speak closer to the microphone?
I just want to say,
Okay, I did not get that. I think that's why we were putting the phones out to bid this month. All right, Scotty, unfortunately we did not hear that, but...
All right.
All right, we will move on to Mrs. Warning.
Hey, first of all, thank you, Dr. Rossi, for not skipping out on us so we can welcome you here. No puns intended, but now that we have all our people here in place, Gateway's off to a good start. First of all, I want to congratulate Gateway with their scores, teachers, staff, students. We're getting back on the right track and going to be putting Gateway back on the map where they should be. We're on the map. We're going to keep growing and getting better and keeping our standards high. So I just want to congratulate that. Little update. I was present today at a presentation over at the high school where there was a speaker that was talking about Flight 93. He wrote a book on it, and I was amazed to watch the students, 10th, 11th, 12th graders, going back to think they were only maybe 1 or 2 years old when this happened. They had no idea really what was happening at that time, where, you know, we would ask you guys, where were you when President Kennedy was shot, or what was happening with when 9/11 happened. These kids were so interested on how he, how he, you know, talked to them and everything. I just want to thank Mr. Wallace for bringing him in. And also, congratulations to our boys and girls volleyball team and to the boys and girls soccer team. They all made it into the playoffs. And to Miss Kristen Gregerson for our homecoming queen this year. Very good girl. Very, very outgoing. Very involved in everything. Great track thrower. That's dear to my heart. And also the website, I believe, is supposed to be coming out this week, Mr. Short. Okay. It's great. You will not believe it till you see it. Also, the bonfire went off really well, the carnival. Thank you to the Monroeville Fire Department for making sure everything was under control with the fire, and it's great working with the municipality. And one other thing I might want to ask to spend a little money, now that we're all here, if we could get maybe new chairs, because Mr. Short keeps going up and down. And
Stephanie's sinking
to tonight's
chair.
So if we, you know, have maybe possibly look into that, whoever takes care of that bit. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Val. Mr. Lapsowitz.
See you tomorrow.
See ya.
Yeah, thank you, Chet. A few weeks ago, my wife had her 50th class reunion from Gateway. I want to give Mrs. Short thanks for touring them through the high school. When they found out I was on the school board, I heard all kinds of good comments. Most of these classmates did not return since graduation 50 years ago. Words like impressed, wonderful, unbelievable were said. I don't think we really know what we have until a stranger points it out. We need to be proud of our district, the caliber of our staff, and our students. Thank you again, Mr. Short, from class 66. And I want to welcome Guy Rosso and Dennis for picking us as your new home. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Very well said. Stephanie.
I would also like to welcome Mr. Rossi, or Dr. Rossi. Dr. Rossi, I apologize. It's very exciting to have you on board. I look forward to all of the exciting changes that you will implement. And also, Dr. Chakey, you've been with us now for a month. It's very exciting to have you on board as well. Great job, Bill, with raising the SVP scores. It's amazing what you've done in just 1 year with the curriculum. I really appreciate it, and I think that I can speak for the parents in saying that we are all very appreciative.
It's the hard work, truly, of the staff and then the students, and also the parents trusting the system. I can't speak enough about our staff incorporating a brand new ELA math and also student management system in 1 year. But they bought in, they believed in it, and the community sees the results, so it's incredible.
Thank you. Also, I would like to make a motion for Gateway School Board to request the municipality of Monroeville to provide Gateway with a Monroeville Police SRO beginning as soon as possible, through at least the appeal of our request for school police has been decided. And the reason that I'm doing this is an answer to several community members. I know Valerie mentioned this at her last study session board report, which is we don't have a backup plan. And this also goes to your comment as well. What's that?
You want them to pay?
Well, obviously, whenever we decided that we needed a school police force because we felt it was important to protect the kids with an armed officer, and we don't have that right now with the exception of one Pitcairn SRO. Last year we had two SROs that were armed. I don't think you can put a price on safety, especially when this school board feels so strongly that having an armed presence does equate to safety.
Well, police then, if we can get a sheriff or somebody else in here at a cheaper rate, maybe we should.
That was a motion.
That was my motion, yes.
We do have a motion. Is there a second? Motion and second.
Questions or comments, Mary Beth?
Yes,
we need to have some discussion on this because we just had a big discussion about budget. We've gone over budget at every the last 2 to 3 meetings we've had. We keep passing things that aren't in our budget now. We've had inquiries, and we sat in a meeting over whether we were within budget for security. One of the reasons that we decided not to keep the Monroeville SRO was because he cost $75,000, okay? Now, if you bring him on, you're probably going to put us over budget. Have you thought about or talked about this with our current security staff? How is that officer going to work with our current security staff, given all of the uncomfortable situations that we've had this year? And Chad can go over all of them if you would like to, Chad, about the no on the gun range, and I could go on and on. The no about meeting. There's not going to be a good working relationship, in my opinion. For you to make this flippantly and vote on it tonight, I will be very upset. I think if you want to make this motion, I would move to table it, and we would allow for public comment before we make another last-minute late night vote without public input.
Is that a motion to table, Mary Beth?
I will make a motion to table.
We have a motion to table. Do we have a second?
John seconds.
We have a motion. We have a second. There will be no other discussion. Roll call, Bonnie, please, to motion or to table the motion of hiring SRO.
Okay,
give me
1 second. Mrs.
Byrne? No.
Mrs. Cerucci?
Yes.
Mr. Lapsowitz?
What is this?
To table it.
Yes, so we'll
table it to allow public input.
I have to think more of this, yes.
Mr. Nola?
Yes.
Mr. O'Donnell?
Yes.
Mr. Ritter?
Yes.
Mr. Steubenbort?
Yes.
Mrs. Warning?
No.
Mr. Williams?
No.
Was that a no?
What was that, Scotty?
That was a no.
No. That will be tabled by a vote of 6-3.
Can I continue with my board report?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. In response to your ABM request for discussion, looking through the ABM Building Solutions guide that was provided to the school district, I didn't see why spending the money for another company to come in and fix toilets, replace faucets, replace light fixtures, when we already have a custodial and maintenance staff, we already have an electrician on staff. And I mean, at the very worst case scenario, if Mr. Brown felt as though he couldn't accomplish these things, which would in effect save energy, he could certainly reach out to a local plumber or a local electrician to work on the projects. As far as replacing an HVAC, I don't see why we would need a third company either to replace an HVAC system. If you know the HVAC system is no longer good, then you simply request for a bid for a new HVAC system and have it installed. And there was another part within the ABM Building Solutions Guide that I found troubling, and that was any sort of rebate that we would have received for the energy cost savings would go to ABM. So, I mean, ABM doesn't make this offer with the intention to not make money on the deal. ABM makes the offer because they know that they can make money on the deal. So that is why I voted no to ABM. And that is all I have this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie.
I'm going to go back just for a moment to the school performance profile numbers that came out. As Bill indicated, that we made another very, very significant leap ahead of a number of very excellent schools. We are now in the top 8 of Allegheny County, top 13 of Western Pennsylvania. But the issue, or the one issue that Bill did not mention, is that we made those gains in an environment where 40% of our students are free and reduced lunch, and our population is far more diversified than any of the schools in the top 13, and I had an opportunity to look that over. So when we think about those gains, I think we have to consider them in this context, and I think it makes the gains even more significant. So my hat's off to the teachers, to the principals. There's no question Guy Rossi had a lot to do with this, as did that's a little levity guy. Yeah, you got it. You're here 2 days, you get the credit. And it starts at the top, Bill. I know you deferred credit, but it starts at the top. If you don't have leadership at the top that drives for excellence in education, my experience is it doesn't happen. And I think you've taken the bull by the ring and you've made it happen. And I have every confidence that we're going to drive that down further into the grade school. So my hat's off to you and to everybody that you made note of in your delivery, because they also participated and made an incredible contribution. And I hope the newspaper's here, right? Newspaper lady. So I'm hoping this is front page news when the Times Express goes to print, because this is an extraordinarily difficult goal to achieve, and we've achieved it, and we've achieved it within that context of no other school having anywhere near the diversity or the free and reduced lunch population. That's huge, okay? And it simply reinforces all kids can learn. So I'll look forward to my...
Nearly every school ahead of us
is averaging around 10 or less than 10% free and reduced lunch.
Yeah, I mean, it's terribly impressive. So let me go to ABM just for a moment. Mary Beth?
Yes, sir.
Did you have a chance to read the ABM proposal in its entirety?
I told you what I read.
Right. Now, you just wanted to double check, maybe you had. And what you said was you had an opportunity to sort of review the summary pages. I'll tell you what, I'm available to sit down with you and go into detail as to why I cast my vote the way I did. Anytime, maybe okay. A lunch or a cup of coffee, I'll go into detail with you on that, okay? Certainly didn't take that decision lightly, but it's the decision I took, okay?
Yep.
Okay, now, and Neil, the same for you, if you have an interest in hearing in detail why I made the decision I made, okay? That's it, that's my report.
Thank you, Mr. Moore. All right, I got a few things, I guess. I'm sorry, I don't always like to take up all the time, but today I want to say a few things.
I said nothing last meeting, if you recall.
Surprising everyone. All right, first thing, the security. We actually, I mean, where we're sitting right now is we have more security than we've ever had, actually. The only difference is one of those people, one, is not armed. But we have way more security than we've ever had. And not only more security, more trained security. And not only that, we're moving to get more SRO-trained security. So, I mean, even if we end up dropping the case thing, I still think that we're on this course with the security because I think that we're better protected than we were, no matter what you say, we're better protected than we were. Like, you know, so I think that we're down this path. I think it's the right path, and I think we're heading down it. So that's my security thing. The next thing. The SPP scores. All right, I mean it's phenomenal. It's just unbelievable. It's there. It also in there was the part of the gap thing too, which was closing for us actually. I mean, not significant enough, not to the level we need, but it was closing, which is good signs. Good signs. And it goes to Steve's point of the diversity that we have and how we're working with it to get it better. I think I've said this story once before, but I want to mention it again because it's personal to me, and it basically has to do with the student success. I've had three kids that went to school here and graduated, and when they go to college, they are way more prepared than any of the other districts around here, by far. And there's several reasons. For that, not bragging about my kids, but I'm just saying that it's because of the things that we offer, the things that we've never cut, the things we continue to offer, staying within the budget that we have, but still offering all the courses that we do. The quick example is my daughter, she had 10th grade honors chemistry. She goes to St. Francis University. Next thing I know, she hadn't had chemistry since. She's now like a, she's since graduated, but she was like a junior at St. Francis. They ask her to be a trainer for chemistry. She's like, I never had chemistry in college or anything. She's like, she had taken some tests and stuff and been in some other classes. They said, you know this stuff better than anybody here. So it's amazing like where we are and the courses that we offer. And that's a testament to this board, to this administration, to the teachers. The teachers, especially these honors, I mean, I've been very fortunate, and I know it, that my children have had these honors courses, but so as many others. It's phenomenal. I'm telling you, it's phenomenal. And when you stack them up with anybody, anywhere, they're better. I know we're 13. I'm telling you, we're better. I know it. All right, so that's about that. The next thing is I wanted to talk about I know when I first started on the board, when I got elected, there was school board training. And it was put on by the IU, the Intermediate Union. And I know that those that got elected with me, which was Stephanie and Chad and myself, and Scotty was too, but I don't believe that he went. But we went to the training. Us three went to the training. And
First of all, it was very good. It was to the point. It taught us what we were supposed to do, what our role was, what the administrator's role was, and all of that. And I think that it's useful. And I'm not sure if everybody went or if they didn't go this time around. I think it was very helpful. I don't know about these two guys that went with me, but I know that it was very helpful. And I think that everybody should go to it if they didn't. I think they put it on. Did they put it on every year, or at least every two? So I think we should consider that. And I'm open to go for another refresher on it too. So I think that it's a good thing. I think everybody should do it. All right. Next thing was the phone system. I mean, all we were doing was putting it out for a proposal to see if we wanted to do something, and I can't figure out why people don't want to consider saving money at some point. I mean, the bottom line is we don't have to do it, actually. We were just putting it out for a proposal, but people were voting against it. I for the life of me, can't figure out why we would not want to save money. Like, it doesn't make sense to me. I think that that's part of our role on the board is to, you know, find ways to save the taxpayers' money. All right, that's that one thing. The next thing is the ABM. The ABM, they're not taking our rebates. The rebates are ours. That's the first thing. I know that one of us said that. I believe that the rebates are ours. We could ask them after the meeting if you wish. The one thing that we've been sitting here for 5 years or longer trying to come up with a plan to do something, and we haven't done it. I look at it, I mean, this isn't even part of what they're doing for us, but I look at it as something that they would do for us. They would prod us along so that we can see, like when somebody comes to you and says, we need a new, it doesn't matter what it is, and it's $600,000. When somebody comes to you and say, well, it's $600,000, I need the $600,000, you're going to say, I'm not so sure. And guess what? That happens. And guess what? The systems continually get worse. But when somebody comes to you and says, if you do this $600,000, I guarantee you in 10 years you will get $300,000 back in savings. And not only will you get it, I guarantee you that you will get it. That's what we're getting. And then they're doing other things too. So I think that they would prod us in the right direction. We brought up how Mr. Brown, I guess we can change all the lights. It would take Mr. Brown, I mean, he does a ton of stuff as it is. It would take Mr. Brown, all day for a year if he did nothing else to change all those lights in all these buildings. And you know, I don't know if he would, nothing against him. I'm not sure if he's going to change them right, if we're going to be up on the latest stuff and all this stuff. You know, there's like systems that need to be put in place when you do those things too. It's not just like go in and put a new light fixture up. There's systems to go along with those things. So that's another thing about ABM. And then the third thing is we've been coming up with things that we need to do, but they actually are going to tell us the useful life of all the things. Let's take, for instance, we think we need a new boiler at Evergreen, let's say, for what, you know, whatever, it doesn't matter, just make it up. The first thing they're going to do is come through with every single thing that in every building in the entire district. They're going to come with this, and they're going to tell us the useful life of this is. And it's going to be all these things. When it says boiler on there and it says it's good for 6 more years, I don't want to replace it next year. Maybe that's what their business is, to guide, to prod, to you know, lead you in the right direction. That's what the whole purpose of the management of that. It's a bigger picture view of the entire process. It's not just I want to go do that. I want to go do that. I want to go do that. We're trying to get our hands around the whole thing so that we progress forward in getting these things done. Because from what I've seen, we haven't done those things yet. We need to get moving on them. I'm sorry to harp on all these things. I think I only have one more thing, and it has to do with I hate to be critical of anybody because I appreciate everything that everybody does, but we need the administrators to run this district, and we need to guide them. We need to be there to support them. We need to write the policies that they need for their guidance. They need to help us in that process. We need to have a trust back and forth. But I strongly believe, and it was actually one of the first things that was said at the school board training, the administrators run the district. That's what they do. They need to, on the administrator side, they have a job too. They need to not hear from this person or that person or this constituent or whatever. And they need to push back. They need to say, you know what, Neil? No, I don't think that we should do it that way, but we can talk about it and try to come up with what's right. They need to take a strong leadership role in running the district, because that's what their job is. Their job's to run the district. They need to take a strong leadership role in running the district. We need to take a strong leadership role in just focusing them and focusing the entire district. That's what our roles are. And if we do that, we'll have trust, because every issue that comes down the line, I'm not going to know everything about. But if I got total confidence in Mr. Rossi or Mr. Short or what, I know he's got it. I got his back. He's got my back. That's how you build that trust. That's how you build the trust, by letting those people do their jobs to the best of their ability. I'm sorry to be so long-winded about it, but those are my feelings, and I'm done.
Thank you, Neil. We were on track for an hour and a half meeting, but I'll keep mine brief.
So a few things. Number one, Nancy, thank you again for following up for the Narcan. Like you said, that will be reviewed tomorrow, and hopefully next month we can have something on 30-day display as far as that goes. No, thank you. Where to move to next? I guess we'll start with the ABM one. It's a phrase that's been said a million times, but paralysis from over-analysis, and that's really what I think we're suffering from here right now. When I got on the board, I had asked, you know, coming from a business standpoint, what's our 5-year plan? What's our 10-year plan? So they went through a bunch of different offices. They found this book, and they blew the dust off of it, and there was our 5-year plan. Nothing was followed. Nothing was updated. Nothing was done. So then we started looking at, okay, are we going to close the school? That seemed to be the majority of directors then and now said, we're probably gonna have to look at some type of consolidation at some point in the next few years. So we looked at different companies, we took bids from them to look at doing some type of consolidation study, because I don't believe the best thing to do is just jump right into it, but to get some data and then to make our decision. So our decision tonight to not use ABM, I think, was, you know, making a decision not to act is a decision in and of itself. So we said, okay, we're just going to, you know, kick the can down the road again. We have a lot of things that we need fixed at Gateway. So much so to the point where, you know, we've had board members bring up motions to buy, you know, air conditioning units to put in windows because we need HVAC in these buildings. So just to clear up, I guess, for the public, because I know most of the board members have gone through it, but ABM, we weren't signing a contract that, okay, we're going to do $10 million worth of projects. It wasn't anything like that. It was, hey, we're going to work with you guys. You guys are now going to go through and see what the life of all of our current assets are, what needs replaced. Give us a timetable. This needs replaced sooner than this needs replaced. Then as a board, we can make decisions and have debates and really have good dialogue between the community and through our staff and other board members as to what that process should look like. Should we do everything in one? Should we just do a, I'm just throwing a number out there, so don't quote me on the number, but should we do a $10 million project and get everything done in the district? Should we do a 3-year plan? Should we do a 4-year? Should we do a 5-year plan? How does that look? So if we had moved forward with just doing one roof, just doing one HVAC unit, Gateway would not pay a single dollar more than it would cost to do that roof or do that said HVAC unit. That's all this motion was to allow ABM to move to the next step that we're going to move forward. I think everyone here knows we have to move forward with some of these things. I mean, if we don't, I really don't know what we're going to do with. I mean, we better look at trailer pricing pretty soon because that's our next option. So I ask everyone to revisit that. I ask, you know, if there are questions, I know some people met with them prior to, you know, sit down with Bob, sit down with ABM. You know, if we want to sit down, have a public meeting, have a buildings and grounds open to the public and really start to look at things and answer any questions people still have, I think that's a great idea. But I do believe we need to make a decision because if we continue this, I mean, when I got on 3 years ago, we said, okay, we need to do something. And then, okay, well, a new board's coming on in a year, so we'll wait until then. Well, then is now, and I think we need to look into doing something. So that's all I'll say there. Got an email today from the Band Boosters, and I want to give them a huge shout out. So if everyone remembers back in, I believe it was February, we had renamed the auditorium to the Robert Reed Center for Performing Arts. The band took it upon themselves, the Band Boosters, to actually raise the money to pay for the lettering. So they were the ones who had petitioned the community to change the name, which I think is a very good move, having Mr. Reed myself. But then they went a step further and actually raised money on their own to pay for that. So I just want to give a huge shout out to Rick Kokel and everyone involved, anyone who had donated money, anyone who had raised money for that. Great job, and thank you very much on behalf of the district for that.
Should we contact Rick?
I believe he'll be in contact with you to
Okay. Set
up that. Yep. Alrighty. So then the next one I just wanted to talk about was, and I know just about everyone has touched on it, the school performance profile. So I just want to go through some of these schools that we beat, and we beat pretty handedly just to get the word out there. So Cannon McMillan, Peters Township, Hemfield, Shaler, North Hills, Bethel Park, Penn Trafford, Plum. And these weren't close. These were, Plum was at 80.8. We were at 89.8. And that's almost a letter grade difference. That's huge. Penn Trafford, 81. Again, we were almost at 90. Bethel Park, 81.
Okay.
Bethel Park, 84. Like, we crushed these districts. So kudos to administrators. Kudos to the teachers. And, you know, the biggest factor, you know, the kids just did a great job. They reacted to the teachers. The teachers were able to change some things up. And, you know, I was very, very pleasantly surprised with the 84 last year. And then to bump it up to an 89.8, like, that's amazing. So if anyone says, oh, Gateway's really gone downhill, tell them to call me because that's ridiculous. This is at a better state than when I graduated in 2008. So we're definitely going in the right direction. And I feel with Dennis, with Guy, with Bill here, we're only going up from there. So with all that being said, we did all of that with a very good budget. We've had to make cuts. We've had to cut some of the fat from prior years and prior board's decisions. And people were always cautious, you know, hey, what's that going to do? I just want to thank this board, and hopefully I can say the same thing next year at this point in time. But thank you for making cuts, but thank you for making cuts that don't affect the educational experience. So for our students to go from an 84 to an 89 with some of those cuts, that's showing that, okay, we cut where we could, but we kept everything that was vital in place and added to that. So congratulations again to everyone, the students, the teachers, the staff, the administrators. You guys are doing a great job. I hope we continue to do that. The other thing, I don't know if you're here reporting, Gideon, but Emily and Gideon have never told me how to do my job, so I won't tell them how to do theirs. However, if we don't happen to be on the front page, as Steve alluded to, I think the board should look at taking out some advertisements, should look at actually spending some money to show the community how good we really are. If you go to a hospital, I'm in hospitals every day for work. If you go to Presby, if you go to AGH, you see these big banners, right? U.S. World News Report. Well, we have one of those. We have a silver medal from them. You know, top three in Pennsylvania for hearts and top this. And I think we need to start getting the word out there. I think we've allowed it to go to a point where we've let these rumors kind of circulate, and now people begin to believe it. We need to tell them, hey, we are top quartile in Allegheny County. We're top 10% in our region. That's huge. So I'll start to put together some numbers and maybe present it at the next study session. But I do think we need to start to get the word out there. If that costs a little bit of money, I think it's well worth it because, you know, our reputation, I mean, we have a great school here. We need to make sure that people know we have a good school here. So
if I could just add one more item.
Yep.
Prior to the study session in November, We're currently looking at all of the data with all the schools. We will be providing this board in our community with a report on student achievement for this year, which is something that we haven't done in the past, but I felt it was critical. That's why we're here, for education, that our stakeholders know exactly where we're at and what we're doing.
Very good. Thank you, Bill. With that, I think I'll just end with that. That's a good note to end on. So do I have a motion for adjournment?
Motion to adjourn.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Seeing one, motion passes.